Okay, so welcome to that little conversation that I'm having with this little red button down here. And I just want to say thank you all for being here today. It's always a great honor and it's a privilege to be a part of best practices. Last year was the first time that I was able to team up with Tim Schwann. My name is Steve Wagner, by the way. Able to team up with Tim Schwann as we were reporting back some of what we were learning as we put together a project with between Thrivent Leadership Network and also the Pastoral Leadership Institute. So we were kind of combining, we're creating a learning community here around the idea of generosity. And so some of what you're going to be hearing today are some of the things that we learned along the way that at first were just assumptions, and we checked against those and said that was a good one, that wasn't such a good one. But we learned some things along the way that we're able to share today that I hope will be helpful to you. This is a best practices conference, and so I invited Nate Schaus, who is from the Phoenix area, Buckeye, right? Am I remembering that correctly? From Summit Community Church, who was a part of one of these learning communities that was meeting with Leadership Network and Thrivent. And so as a congregation, they were learning to be doing. And so I've asked Nate if he would come and share some of the best practices today. Laurie Wilkinson, you'll hear from her later in the afternoon at the end. Yes, we want you to bring some greetings and just share a few words. Also from Thrivent, who was a very important part of getting us to this place of learning together. So we're talking about unleashing your congregation's generous urge. That's what we're about. Let me open this with a word of prayer and we will get into this. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity that we have this afternoon to meet together, to learn from one another, to hear information that is a part of a learning process, to connect with your heart, which is amazingly generous, extraordinarily generous, and perfect in every way toward us for all of eternity. Thank you, Lord, for that, and we pray that we leave here encouraged by best practices and by a sense of your Spirit urging us to live lives of great generosity. So to that end, we offer this prayer in Jesus' strong and precious name. Amen. I want to just quickly talk to you about some of the objectives of our workshop time together. First of all, number one, gain insights from congregations that are growing a culture of generosity. Please hear me say this from the get-go. Generosity is not a program. We're not going to talk to you about a program. We're going to talk to you about a way of giving expression to faith in Jesus Christ. There are people who today, as they engage this question in a good way, in a theological way, in a way to find what God's Word teaches about these things of generosity, are saying, this really is a way of thinking about discipleship. This really is a way of thinking about evangelism. This really is a way of thinking about advancing the kingdom of God. And in my experience of this, which at least in a more intense way has just been over the last 4 or 5 years, I would say that there's great truth in those kinds of things. So we're talking about culture, not program. Number two is to feel inspired by the stories and lessons learned from living generously and purposefully as Jesus followers. Generously and purposefully. Those will be the key words as we follow Jesus Christ. And number three, to identify next steps useful for personal and or congregational generosity. And we not only want to talk about some ideas, but we want to put some skin on ideas today. And Nate's going to do that for us, sharing some of the things that happened at Summit. Now, here's what we, as we plan our day together, we are moving toward a spot where there'll be plenty of time for interaction and questions and those kinds of things, so that as you are thinking about something, I think it'd be fair to say, Tim, don't you, that a person can hold up a hand and we'll be happy Absolutely. To engage the Yeah. question. But we've tried to build in at least 20 minutes at the end where questions can be asked, and hopefully you'll find this to be a very stimulating time this afternoon. Tim, I'm going to ask you to come forward then and go ahead and lead us into the first part of this, which deals with these learning communities that were this kind of working partnership between PLI, Thrivent, and Leadership Network.
Thanks, Steve. It's a blessing to be here. Blessing to be with you. And I mean, what's going on here with this best practices ministry is an extreme act of generosity on the part of this congregation, and it's just amazing. So it's I think 1,926 people, I think is what Jeff said. What you're part of is here to learn more about how to live purposefully and generously under the cross of Jesus Christ is pretty amazing. Just a little background before, again, we're going to share some learnings, a little bit of background, so you have this context around what Nate's going to share a little bit later. The key question that kind of got this work started, this partnership started, between Leadership Network Thrive, and PLI was involved in this, and some other pastors, is what does it take to deepen and accelerate a movement of generosity in a congregation? The title of this workshop is Unleashing Your Congregation's Generous Urge. So one of the operating assumptions around this is we didn't necessarily believe you had to create that. Oh, I'm sorry, I have to stand there. We did not believe that you had to create this urge, this idea of wanting to live generously as a congregational community. Our belief was that it's there. And how do you stimulate it? And that belief is based on the fact that God, the most generous being in the universe, right, in his creative, redemptive, and sanctifying work, God created us in his image. I have a friend who was in one of the first cohort groups from Thrive, and Terry Wold, who's a managing partner in St. Louis. And he added some context around this by saying, you know, when I meet with people, one of the ways I get to some common ground with them is I ask them a question like, have you ever had a charitable urge? And he said, you know, nobody has ever said no. Everybody he's met, nobody has said no. And he said, so we kind of build our relationship around that, some discussion around that. So a couple other operating assumptions were that the way to accelerate an active learning environment is to do it in community, right? To gather together missional congregations that had strong pastoral leadership, who are kind of committed to this idea of living generously as a community and individually, that we were going to do this in a very flexible way, non-prescriptive. Because what you'll hear from Nate, what works at Summit isn't what works at my home congregation, Faith, in Appleton, Wisconsin. But the ideas are transferable, the concepts are. And then also to have a community where there's a lot of encouragement, a good deal of trust to do these kinds of things, where there's shared experimentation around congregational culture, changing congregational culture, where there's active learning, culture change, and movement acceleration. So that's a little bit of the context. Keep going the wrong way here. So just a little bit about what we've discovered and learned from these congregations. There were about 18 congregations in two different cohort groups that we learned from about what it is and what it isn't. And the sheet that you have at your table is built around this. And I'm just going to say a couple of words about this, a lot of detail. The way I would describe these, does everybody have one of these?
No.
Oh, we missed
a table. Got a few more copies.
Yeah.
Here. Raise your hand if you need one.
Wow, okay. The way I think about these is when you think about culture, there are cultural markers in any organization. And those are kind of this set of behaviors that you see in any organization. And so when you think about culture change, it's really about changing the behavior of those who make up that organization. And as we've kind of observed the congregations, these are some of the things that we started to see that a generous culture was more like versus less like. And that doesn't mean a generous culture doesn't deal with budget and money relationship. It's there. it's just as it's accelerating its growth in generosity, it's becoming more and more like heart and treasure relationship that Scripture talks about, that Jesus talked about. It's clearly grassroots driven. It gets ideas from other organizations. And I put a couple of websites up here, generouschurch.com. You could take a look at that. Generous.com are great sources. But the grassroots drives it. People in the congregation, their own congregation, cohort groups drive it. Another really important learning is that it's a very spiritual thing. I was telling somebody today that the church allowed our secular world to cop the word generosity and make it kind of a small g generosity. And we started talking about big G generosity, that it's really the image of God type of generosity, living as we are called by God. It's not social, not secular, not a social cause. Andy Stanley, we got this kind of quote from him. It's congregations that are accelerating the growth of generosity in their culture talk more about what God wants for you rather than from you. So when you talk about stewardship, it's not so much what God is trying to extract from your wallet, right? It's about what he wants for you from living generously. And then also through you as you're generous to community. So that's kind of what this sheet is about. And I look at this quite often just to kind of think in our own congregation. So where's our culture, what's it more like? And what's it becoming less like? And I would encourage you, as you're listening to Nate talk, to look at this list and think about your congregation, your congregational community. And what are two or three of these things where you think it'd be great if we become a little bit less like this and a little bit more like the other thing? And you might add other things to the list, okay? All right. Quickly, lessons learned. Generosity is at the heart of the gospel. It's congregations that are in this talk about that all the time. Generous worldview is about abundance, not scarcity. It's what I want for you, not from you. Generosity is continuous. It's not seasonal. It's not an event. It's continuous. It becomes a part of the fiber of the generous church community. It's a pastoral issue. And a lot of the change that we saw in these congregations was pastors became much more interested in knowing and understanding any kind of change in the giving life of a member, because that would trigger for them a pastoral moment, a pastoral opportunity. And it's all about mission. Our pastor at Faith would say that generosity is really the new evangelism. That living generously as a community and individually is a way to introduce people to Jesus. And he firmly believes that. So with those kind of thoughts in mind, I think we're going to move on. Do you want to say another word of introduction with Nate? And
yeah, Nate, come. Yeah, please come on forward. Nate was invited to be a part of the second leadership community that we did. Working with the Thrivent and Leadership Network, his congregation, and interesting at a time when he was getting into this whole process was they were kind of a new mission startup. I mean, so they were at a place where they were going to beginning to determine culture, determine norms, create values, and that sort of thing. And so one of the issues that's important for you to hear is that generosity isn't just a conversation for larger churches or older churches. It's a conversation to have from the get-go. When should we have started having conversations about generosity? Well, maybe 20 years ago, but if we didn't do it then, let's do it today. And we invited Nate in saying, let's get a guy in here who can take it from day one. And so part of the story is taking it from day one. Yeah. So, hey, Nate, thanks, man. God
thanks,
bless you.
Appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Well, it is a
pleasure to be here with you today. Thank you for the opportunity to be able to share some of our story with you. Certainly pray for God to bless and work through your churches and your ministries. It's always exciting to see in a setting like this the kind of collaboration that happens from one church in one place to the next. I totally agree with what Steve shared before and what Tim shared. The idea here that pursuing a generous life, pursuing a pattern of generosity within a church, really embracing that as a part of your culture, a way that we really do believe that reflects God's character in our world today. It is so much more of a lifestyle and approach than it is an individual program. So I'll share with you a few examples, some things that we've done, some great moments, and a few things that have been, I would say, catalytic times for our church to help perpetuate that cycle of giving and helping people think differently about that. These are a few of those key insights. So as I think about some of those different steps that we took as a church, as we went through the leadership community, it really did help, not only for me, but a few of our key leaders that came in and out of that process. For me, one of those aha moments from, I think, the first time that we were there, we were speaking about giving within the church, right? One of those times where I was doing a series on that and teaching about that and encouraging people to give. And one of those ways I was challenged there early on, as somebody that has grown in this journey through the years, I tend to challenge people and want to move people forward strongly to where I believe God calls us to be. And one of the things that I realized there early on was the value of celebrating the spiritual growth and the change that are happening for everybody along the way. And that's not only true for us in a startup, mission kind of church, but in established churches, we have people that are in so many different places. And for a pastor, as you look at research, you tend to speak more out of where you are. So if you've grown up in a context or in a culture where you are taught to be generous, or you were doing that, it's much easier to think in terms of tithing or those kinds of things, or the idea of giving, even if you don't get hung up on a specific percentage, to say, look, as a part of your spiritual life, first fruits giving, honoring God, putting Him first. My pattern was very much to be able to teach into, say, a 90-day tithe challenge, or just challenging people to say, God is so good and He will provide. But I would celebrate that far more than I would a person who started to give for the first time. And what I learned along the way is there's incredible spiritual steps of faith that are being taken at every point along the way as people are growing and moving along in this journey of faith. So that was one of my aha moments. And as we've leaned into that with our church, there are times where we really do celebrate. I mean, those first gifts that people give, or the new movement that people are taking, we see the significance of what that means for them. We also talked there about the idea of equipping people at every level, and that was very convicting for me as a lead pastor and for our church, that people are, those categories there might refer to people, all right, for those who are struggling and at risk, living paycheck to paycheck, or just even struggling to get by. There are ways that you minister to people in that context and where you lead them along. And for those that are stable, may have a little bit of margin there, those that are in a solid place, and those that are really in a blessed place in terms of having a surplus of financial resources and what that means. What I found, though, in that conversation is that how you equip and how you speak into people spiritually, it's so different in so many different ways. For instance, coming through the downturn, if you lived in a part of the country in the Southwest or in Florida or in Michigan, went through a terrible downturn in the economy, that was a challenging time, right? I moved into Phoenix right about the time that hit. That was not the expectation for when I moved here to town, where property values in our area on the outskirts of town in some places dropped by as much as 75%. The neighborhood that I lived in for many years there had probably about an 80% turnover in foreclosures and short sales. Just a devastating time for people. So we lean heavily into Financial Peace University and how you train and how you equip. But I realize so often, even there with good intentions, you can zero in and just say, we're going to really try and help people here. And I realized there were so many others we weren't leading along in that journey, either in terms of tools and training and help to be a great steward of what God had given to them, and to help them grow in terms of how they think about generosity. Generosity in our community, some of those aha moments. This has been a part of our culture at Summit, where we look for ways to say, as a community church, we're completely sold out to want to be a part of our community, engage locally. So one of those ways that we've looked to be able to build partnerships where we will not only serve or do that is to find ways where we can serve with our community in other ways. How many of you have heard of Feed My Starving Children? You know that organization? Great. In our side of town, in the region here, on the, at least in the far west valley, we're one of the first churches over there to launch that. There's a Tempe site, and a lot of churches will do mobile pack events. We, a number of years ago, took a step of faith and said, let's pack 100,000 meals in one weekend, do a mobile pack. We worship in a high school. We still worship in a high school. And said, look, we can do this. Host it on that campus. Get the school, get other community partners, other people involved as a part of that. And if you've never seen something like this, this will give you a quick look at our high school campus and some of the ways that we have worked with Feed My Starving Children to be able to make an impact and move not only our church to say, how do we live generously for the sake of others, but invite our community to be a part of that too. It's created some great conversations. So see if you can scroll over with the mouse and find that couple of minute video from our FMSC event this last year. You can see people cheering there at the end as we prayed over meals and did that. One of the things that you will discover, and we've seen that in our community, is that there is so much joy that flows out of generosity, you know, and living for other people. I tell people all the time, you know, especially with a lot of our families, you know, I firmly believe, right, that, I mean, there is a generous urge that God's given to us. I firmly believe that every parent in your congregation, every grandparent wants their kids and grandkids to have a generous mentality, not an entitlement mentality. Every parent wants their kid to grow up. They want them to go out from the nest really appreciating what they have, what they've been given, rather than feeling, you know, like they're always entitled to the next thing and doing that. It is just it's a beautiful way to be able to live. And what we've seen there over time by picking this, and again, this, for every community, and I don't know what that looks like in your region and your area, this became a great partner for us along the way, one of those things that we do. But what I found was this, that when you actually engage in something that blesses other people there. This last year, we ended up packing 300,000 meals, which took 1,200 volunteers and about, I don't know, $50,000 or $60,000 for that weekend. That's more volunteers than people we have in worship. We could not do that without our community. And what happens is, as you engage, as you provide avenues and ways for people to join in generosity, come together, it builds common ground, it opens up conversations. I can't tell you how many times as I've networked and spent time in the community, say through the, I spent a lot of time with the Chamber of Commerce, personally involved locally in the community, have connections in lots of places. How many people have come up to me with that story of, you know, I really got burned or turned off by a church or here. Every church that I've seen, kind of from a sideline, so often, it just seems like churches that I've known always want to know what they're going to be able to get from you. And I've had people that have been out of the faith for a lot of years and times that just say, look, I'm not going to church yet, but if I did, I would probably go to your church or want to be a part of this. They said, it really seems like from the community, it seems like your church actually cares what they can do for the community, what you can do for the community, how you can serve others. It's not just what you can get from people. And that's the beauty of building a culture of generosity. And that's the beauty of doing that with your community. For us, we talk about life-changing generosity as one of our core values. We think that it not only is life-changing for those that are the recipients, are impacted by acts of generosity, I mean, through churches and ministries, but also in personal, tangible ways. But we also believe that generosity is life-changing. It's something God, it's a transforming way he works in our lives. And we want people to experience that. It is something we want for them. Online tools and resources, you know, we certainly have, you know, along the way through that process, taken a look at, we've added a Summit app and some of those kinds of ways. It's amazing how people do give and participate in many different ways. So you can look up that with Summit Community Church online. We've got, there's so many tools and resources that are available right now. If you just connect up, and I would agree with Generous Church, Generous. I'll show you something here from Generous Giving from another organization, generousgiving.org. That would be another one that you, in fact, would you mind adding that to the list, generousgiving.org? So many great tools and resources. Don't put that pressure on yourself to feel like you've got to start from scratch, or that, you know, there's so much great learning that can be done in collaborative spaces like this and from other organizations. Leadership Network is their hub process is a great resource as well. The Journey of Generosity retreat, I spoke before about how discipling and leading people along in this generosity journey, especially going through what we did in the region, so often we focus so much of our help and attention and equipping on those that were going through times of crisis or going through, you know, buried by debt or living with the housing downturn and all those kinds of things. The Journey of Generosity retreat, we just hosted one for the first time this last fall, and it was an amazing blessing for some of our families that are business owners and are people that that I would say are more in that surplus, that are in that surplus position in life where they have done well financially. One of the things that I heard in that conversation as we walked through this, that sometimes the least discipled people, the ones there that sometimes may be the largest givers in your church or own businesses or in a place where God has blessed them, oftentimes the church does the least to invest in and help those people in terms of their faith journey, in terms of understanding the responsibility of what God's given to you or the tension of what comes along with trying to manage resources. And so this Journey of Generosity retreat was something that we learned about through that process. There's generousgiving.org. We did a retreat. It's designed to be an overnight setting. They host these, they have trainers and people. There's a foundation that helps to underwrite these so that in an act of generosity, to be able to host a weekend retreat or experience that really is designed around higher capacity givers or business owners or people that have greater means. It's a retreat setting that is facilitated. Somebody will come in, and there is no cost to the congregation. There is no cost to the participants individually to be a part of that. The foundation helps to underwrite this to say, we really want to be able to create a conversation, a place where people can talk about generosity, share some stories, connect with each other, and there really is no ask. That foundation will not ask for money. They won't take money because they want to be able to have a conversation. As you've said here before, that it's not about what we want from you. This is something we want for you. And we had about eight couples that went through that from our church, and it was just a beautiful experience to see them participating in that. And it became a time to reflect on. They've used some great video stories, testimonies of people that have walked through that generosity journey of coming to terms with and understanding how God's at work in their life, what it means to grow in generosity, the difference that that makes in their families and in their spiritual life, and was very enriching personally for those who are part of that. And that's been one of the things that we've done, again, trying to say, how do we bring along people and help to build a deeper culture of generosity in our church? Right now, we're in the middle of a series that we are doing called The Genius of Generosity. And this book and this resource, so there's a Bible study resource by Chip Ingram. And and this is out of generouschurch.com. And they have a number of different resources and things there. At Summit, we have a very extensive small group network in our church. From very early on, we've said we're going to do three things, do them well. Sunday worship, our groups, we want to mobilize people out in neighborhoods and out in the community as they gather and as they connect with their neighbors, and then serving in our community and making an impact that way. So once a year, we'll do a church-wide series where all of our growth groups and our children and youth will focus in on the same topic. It's what we're doing right now. So we're in the middle of a series that's for about the month of February for 4 or 5 weeks. Is all about the genius of generosity. You know, that certainly in terms of how that moves us financially, but also, what does a generous life look like? And why is that such a blessing? And why does the Bible and God's Word speak about it the way that it does? So, we chose this and did this series with our church because we know this is one of the most critical times during the year where everybody is praying about the same things, focusing on the same topic, doing this all together in alignment. It's one of the most powerful times we have during the year to be able to build culture. And so this is a time where we said, look, if we want to build, if we're serious about building a culture of life-changing generosity in our church, let's take this time to have an extended conversation with our church as a whole. And to that point, for instance, we had somebody with the Genius of Generosity series that came up to me. I shared this story at the beginning of my message last week. A couple of weeks ago, a guy came up to me and is a fairly new Christian, somebody that's just taken some initial steps of faith. And he came up to me and he said, Pastor Nate, can you pray for me? I just want to share something with you. I said, yeah. He said, my truck got stolen this last week. And he said, I'm doing remarkably well handling that. I said, okay, this is not the way that conversation normally goes, so tell me more. And he and his family, they've come every once in a while. And about a month and a half ago, I know they've gone through some tough stuff. And they really have they've been there weekly for about the last month and a half in worship. And he said, just a few weeks ago, I would have had such a different response to this, to my truck being stolen. I would have been angry. I would have been bitter. I would have been frustrated. It would have totally changed my whole outlook. And he said, this series that we're doing there at church, The Genius of Generosity, he said, that is totally, it's changed the entire way I think about that. He said, this idea that it's not really my stuff, that it's God's stuff, right? That I get to, you know, God's given me this. This is what I get to handle and take advantage of that and use that for his kingdom. He said, that idea that we learned here as the first part of the series, that it's not really mine, it's God's. He said, it made it a lot easier to come to terms with the fact that somebody stole the Lord's truck, not mine, and that God's going to provide and lead me through that. And so here's the deal. So he shared that with me a couple of Sundays ago, grabbed that, you know, and then just last Saturday, I got a text from him, and he said, guess what? They found my truck. So I shared this on Sunday morning. I said, you want to know the rest of the story? And they said, yeah. So I said, they found the truck. And And it was a little older truck, and it had a few issues and all that. And he said, you wouldn't believe it, when the police found my truck, they had fixed my air conditioning, the people who stole it. They said, and it really needed some body work, and so they had fixed the body on the truck. He said they had given it a tune-up, and they had installed a shell on the back of my pickup. So I not only got my truck back, the Lord brought it back with upgrades. And it was one of those great stories where we're moving people to give more generously, live more generously, but it really is about building a foundation of what God wants for us and how we think, right? And it's just a great moment there to be able to see, for this new believer, I can just see the way that his faith is changing. He's now looking at this and saying, I'm starting to look at life differently. And that's the beauty of that, when you help people make the shift from thinking, I've earned it all, it's all mine, I get to make all the choices about this, to really think, man, even my ability to be successful, my ability to have the skills, the talents, the abilities, the opportunity that I do, all of that is a gift from God. It's wonderful to see what happens. Like for that man, it not only moves him to greater generosity, it changes how he views crisis. It changes how he views stress in his life. It changes how he views, as Jesus taught, right? You know, I mean, seek first the kingdom of God and all these things will be given to you as well. So to launch this series off, we wanted to involve people, youth, kids, adults, everybody, in a very experiential way, so that on the first Sunday, we did tell people, we're going to do something differently this Sunday, don't miss it. But there was a very small handful of people who knew what was going to happen that morning at church. And we'd been praying about this, we'd wrestled, all right, Lord, how can we do something, again, that helps to break some of those stereotypes, that giving is not just about what people do for the church, but how do we make an impact in our community and do that? So here's what we chose to do. We had decided with the team that we wanted to take a Sunday where we would end worship early and send people out and say, we want you to go clear the shelves at a local grocery store in our community. So mayor's happy because you're shopping local. But go clear shelves, go do that, and we're going to give 100%, give all of that away to Phoenix Rescue Mission. So if you're here in the area, a great organization that works with the homeless in lots of different ways in the city. And we said, look, we just want to be an unexpected blessing to them. So the grocery store knew about it. A team of people at Summit knew about it. And Phoenix Rescue Mission knew about it. They had about 3 or 4 trucks that were there to be able to pick up stuff there that morning. But here was the clear the shelves way that we started off this series. Take a look. We had lines all the way to the back of the store. I mean, you pray and you hope everybody's going to respond, but people just flooded out of there from church over to the local grocery store. You had lines all the way to the back. We had people afterwards who said, you know, I've been a part of church for almost my whole lifetime. I've never seen something like this. And it was, you had people there who, as they stood in line, as they did that, might have been there for 30 or 40 minutes in line, you know, moving through. And we basically had like a fast pass for everybody that actually walked in there to go shopping to get them to the front of the line. But it was just a great experience. Our people are still buzzing about it. They always use the hashtag Summit Gives, again, culture building, trying to say, look, this is just a part of who we are and what we do. And along the way, what we've seen from that, again, the conversation for people, it's helped people. There was so much joy around that and what happened there that day. Of course, now we're teaching into don't let generosity be a one-day experience. But that day there, the response was just incredible. We ended up, Phoenix Rescue Mission had about 4 trucks there and trailers to be able to haul stuff away. They filled all those up, including some refrigerated ones. Ran out of those. We had other people that brought trailers from the church, went and got their stuff. Ended up having to go rent a U-Haul truck and trailer as Vince and I drove the last load down there at the end of the day. But it was beautiful. Ended up donating enough there for more than 20,000 meals that day in one shot. And I hope and pray it'd be a great thing for Phoenix Rescue Mission. It was nice to get a little bit of news coverage, you know, it just for the sake of Phoenix Rescue Mission and those kind of ministries. It'd be great to see if that sparks some generosity in more churches, in more places there as well. I saw one of the cashiers in line that next week. I went in, it's where I do my grocery shopping there locally, and she was so excited. She all of a sudden, she was looking at me and she said, "You're one of the pastors from over at Summit." Yes. And she said, "That was just amazing." And you know what she said to me? She said, on Sunday when everybody was coming through, she said, "You know what that was?" She said, "That wasn't charity. That was generosity." I'm like, "Oh, can you say that on camera again?" But she said, and I said, "Well, why? Tell me more about that." She said, "You know what? I've seen, you know, people give to lots of different things. You'll have like the food, you know, the canned food drive where people will come and, you know, buy a few things or hand something off or do that." But she said two things. She said, "Look, people would come up there with," she said, "kids would come buying stuff, you know, with their allowance money, or people would come up there and they would have a full cart or a couple of carts." And she said, "For a while I was asking, you know, so how much of this is for you and how much of this are you going to give away?" And she said, "I just kept hearing over and over, well, we're going to give it all away." And she said, "People were so happy to be able to do it." She said, "It was generosity because it was open-handed. It wasn't, all right, this is for me and I'm going to do a little bit here. It wasn't just an act of charity." You could tell that people were really moved and there was a different attitude about the giving that took place that day than from what she'd seen before. So my last point for you here is that connection to evangelism that I have seen. And in fact, I had somebody that I've been praying for and reaching out to, a guy named Sam who owns a business out in our community there, is one of those guys that has been gone from church for, oh, good night, since he was probably a kid. And he found me. I was at a chamber quarterly breakfast here a couple of weeks ago. And I saw Sam and he came up to me and Sam said, "Man, that was just awesome with the whole bashes thing, the grocery store thing." And I said, "Oh, did you see it on Facebook?" Because our people were just lighting it up. We've never seen more buzz, you know, in terms of people. We didn't even tell people to do it. It just happened. But he said, but I asked him, "Did you see it on social media?" He said, "Well, no, I had a couple of friends from your church that said, hey, we're going over there. You should come be a part of this with us." And so he came and he was there that day. And Sam, who's very jaded about the church, you know, thinks, has this attitude and mentality that the church is just here to get stuff from people and all that. Sam said, "Well, my daughter's starting to go to, you know, your youth ministry stuff every once in a while. I'm really the last holdout in my family." He said, "You know what, the next time," since he does mountain biking with a bunch of guys from our church, he said, "the next time that Armin is on in the worship cafe. It's one of our worship venues there at the church. He said, the next time Armin's helping with that, he said, I think I'm going to come to worship with you guys. I'm going to come be there and see Armin the next time he's on. And I said, that would be awesome. I said, now know this, it's a generosity series, so we're talking about money and stuff and all these kinds of things. And I said, just fair warning. And you know what he said? This guy that's been jaded about the church for so many years, he said, that's the reason why I want to come. Because I see that you guys actually look at this differently than most people do. So it's been a cool, we are just getting started on this. I can't wait to see what God's going to do in terms of building our culture of generosity over time. So hope some of that may help or spark some ideas or thoughts for you. Eric, that's about 33 minutes. A little more time for questions.
Hey, thank you. Thanks, Nate. Yeah. You feel inspired a little bit by that? Yes. Isn't that cool? That's why being part of this journey with these congregations is, it messes with me. Chris Willard, who wrote the book Contagious Generosity, mm-hmm. He told us that if you start getting into this and you start hearing these stories, it messes with you. I mean, I lay awake at night thinking about stories like this and about moments where I could definitely live generously a lot differently than what I've chosen to do. Here's an example. I was driving out to meet a friend to do some golfing the other day. The traffic out here is a lot different than it is in Appleton, Wisconsin. And I had this car trying to get in, and I was competing with him, and I wasn't going to let him in. And I didn't let him in. And then I thought, well, how stupid is that? Why didn't I let him in? Well, I had a moment to be generous there, and I missed it. Anyway, so we're going to wrap up with just a couple thoughts, and then we're going to open up for questions of Nate and Steve and others. Steve and I thought it'd be good to say, okay, so what's going on with this movement? This little piece of the generosity movement that we started probably about 3 years ago, or that the Lord started. And it's interesting because we kind of sensed, okay, well, these 16, 18 congregations go through that and they'll take off and they'll just do some cool things in their own community. But what we found out is, as it's messed with the leaders of those congregations, that they want to do more. You know, they said, we benefited from that so much. And you heard Nate say, he's realized they've just started this journey. And so they said, how are we going to continue this journey for us as a congregation, but also help bring brother and sister congregations into this journey to help grow it? There's five pastors who've kind of started this generous congregation learning communities, what we call 2.0, all right? And it really is this kind of a natural extension of a generosity movement. If you, I've done a little reading on social movements, and this whole thing with generosity is ripe for creating these kind of grassroots movement, because it changes lives. It gets people, and people think and feel different, and they're seen differently. So, in a small little places in upper Midwest, Wisconsin, Illinois, the idea here is that the congregations that have been on this journey are going to become host congregations, and they're going to invite 7 to 10 other congregations to join them for a 2-year journey. And their thinking is, to even get started on this, you've got to start small. It's got to start doing some things, and it takes a couple of years to test ideas and try things and get feedback from other congregations. So that's what they're going to do. They're going to invite, our local congregation, the one I go to in Faith in Appleton, Wisconsin, going to invite 10 other congregations from the North Wisconsin District and some other folks locally, and to join them in continuing the journey. And they'll meet 4 times face-to-face. They'll create an opportunity to learn and share from each other. So these are the hosting, facilitating congregations, and they're using the same kind of model, where there's going to be in the name of Jesus, this kind of shared experimentation, what we call very active learning. In other words, you learn by doing. It's not from books and textbooks and that kind of thing, although those are useful resources. But you actually, the real power is to say, create a plan, and to say, here's what we're going to do, and then go out and do it. And if it didn't work, to understand why it didn't work as well as you wanted it to. And then to take those learnings and say, okay, so what do we need? What do we want to, based on what we learned, what do we want to learn next in this generosity movement? And then to go about real culture change and movement acceleration. I think one of the things I've noticed about these congregations is, again, they wouldn't take on the whole thing, but they go after two or three of these cultural markers that we've talked about. And Nate's been great at this, of doing what I call Lincoln Label for culture change. It's really important to say, we're doing this, and this is the reason we're doing it. It's to become more Christ-like in our generosity, and to continue to link what you're doing as a congregation, as a community, and individually, back to our calling to live generously. So that's what's now. Will all these get started? You know, the lead pastors are working on trying to get it going. We'll see. They're in the process now of just starting invitations to the other congregations, and we'll see. I think they want to launch in the fall. Randy Rush is one of the, his wife's here, good to have her here. He's pretty charged up about this, as well as our pastor. So I think God's going to do something through it. It could be a lot of fun. So you might want to watch how that goes. Now, that's not something that you can participate in, unless you want to fly to the upper Midwest. But there's another thing going on. I mean, Leadership Network is how we all kind of got started in this. A gentleman named Chris Willard, I'll write the name up here, who wrote the book Contagious Generosity, was really a find for us. He's been working in this generosity space with Christian congregations for a decade, maybe, right? I mean, and he's just a fun guy to lead, to learn from. But they've evolved their whole inspiring generosity into a thing they call hubs. So if you went out and looked for Leadership Network hubs, and this is the website, you can find out what they're doing now to bring together cohort congregations to work together to accelerate this growth of a culture of generosity in their congregations. And if you could do it, I think you would really benefit from it. I know we all have. I wanted to have Lori, colleague of mine from Thrivent, just spend a couple minutes talking about some of the things that Thrivent's doing to help congregations live generously, and we call it the ABCs. And yeah, so would you be willing to do that? Well, let's give Lori a welcome.
I can. I see some of our Thrivent fellows out in the audience as well, so thanks for being here.
Yes, that mic to talk.
Over here. All right. I really hadn't prepped anything. I thought I'd just be here to ask for, you know, answer some questions if they came up, but always love the chance to share a little bit. You know, it's very interesting in terms of culture shaping. It really is not a program or a project necessarily, but very much test and learn, like Tim and Nate had shared. And you need to make it your own. You need to own it and make it your own. So I think some of these are great ideas. And also, the other thing that's really exciting that's happening at Thrivent, and for those of you that don't know us, our purpose is to help our members be wise with money so they can live even more generous lives. And we have a lot of fun doing that, but we have a lot to learn also in that space. And so we're doing research as much as we're also activating people. And it's around that 5S journey, similar to what Nate had shared. People's perceptions about money, that's where it really gets to be a faith thing, a pastoral thing, helping people. It's a faith-raising versus fundraising thing. How are they feeling about money? And so we're working in that space. We're also positioning some of our stuff in a really cool way around what's your enough. You know, it's not how much can I give, but how much do I actually need? knowing that everything that you have is a gift from God anyway. So it really shifts the conversation differently. And again, we're starting to develop some tools in that space. But one of the things that Tim mentioned was the ABCs. And we talk about our projects or programs of generosity in that way. Thrivent Action Teams, Thrivent Builds, and Thrivent Choice. How many of you are familiar with Thrivent Action Teams? The gray t-shirts versus the orange ones at Summit. We're getting a lot of great activity and activation among our members. Last year, we're just getting the numbers out, we had nearly 20,000 action teams last year. And that number, actually, it's significantly more than that. It was, I think we're close, over 70,000 action teams, actually. And Thrivent Choice, we celebrated 5 years with the Thrivent Choice program. That's an over $50 million program, again, activating our members to be generous. And Thrivent Choice is a program that's available to about a third of our members based on their relationship with Thrivent. Interesting, you may find this, that only about 35 to 40% of those eligible are actually taking advantage of that program. So, more opportunities for them to be generous in the time that they direct their dollars. They can also make a personal contribution at that same time. I just got this in the mail. This is from LWR. I'm going to use this as a quick example. It says, help make Thrivent Choice count. This is from Lutheran World Relief, where they are looking to promote this program and activate their members in giving. And again, just sharing another way, another little nugget of ways that you might think about activating people. And then Thrivent Builds is our other program. So keeping it very simple, ABCs for our members and their families to impact communities in a positive way. So.
Great.
Is that good?
Yeah, well, if awesome. You want to stay up here for questions, we'll move to questions. By the way, just one other great resource around generosity. It's a workshop that Tom's going to be doing
tomorrow.
Tom Gruno. So a lot of good resources and tools and ideas and concepts. So
what's the workshop called?
Building a culture of generosity, yep. And then maintaining a culture of generosity.
There you go.
There's two of them.
What is this workshop called?
This is called Unleashing.
Unleashing.
A culture of generosity.
So it's bait and switch.
So that's it in terms of our formal presentation, but questions for any of the folks up here?
Just for a general one. Yeah. Especially on the intersection of generosity and evangelism. Anybody playing with the old Steve Sogren servant evangelism kind of concepts that are still, is that any part of this anymore?
You know, that's really a great insight. That whole, it's not just the event of servant events, but it's the whole experience around that help people to live kind of generously. I haven't seen it specifically, okay. But you've just given me something else to think about here. I think it's not actually just the event, but it would be that whole
well,
thing of Steve Sonnenberg to create.
Says, I want to do grace before I even try to explain grace.
That's a great idea.
I mean, I forget who said that at one of the settings along the way. I mean, the heart of the Christian church early on, I mean, the place where early on in the first few centuries, and again, it was certainly through the, you know, when the plague was going through Egypt or going through Europe and all that, it was the Christians were the ones that walked into danger and cared for those that nobody else would.
Right.
I mean, it's just an act of living generously actually became synonymous with the Christian church, that they were the strange ones that cared for people that the rest of the system wouldn't.
And that certainly is a complementary what Steve was doing and writing about. Certainly is a way to help me understand this whole concept of living generously, because that's exactly what we see emerging as we see these practices go ahead.
Really practical question, Lori. Mm-hmm. I understand kind of fiduciary responsibility.
Can you flip on that light switch back there?
Any way that, other than a sort of a blanket Thrivent announcement when it comes to choice, is there any way I can target that more accurately among the folks that I know?
You mean in terms of knowing who your Thrivent members are?
Yeah.
Yes,
just
within a congregational setting.
Just driving numbers, not who the third is, you know?
Yes, within your congregation.
Yeah.
Yes. Once it gets to institutions, that's a little bit different
sure.
in terms of some of the privacy issues, but that
right.
is available, so.
It is available.
Mm-hmm.
But is it, so all, who all of your, all the Thriving members are, not whether they're eligible
right,
for
right, right,
right.
I understand
I,
that. Yeah.
Yes, and I guess
what
I should qualify,
I
guess I should qualify that by saying, our members at times will have their church information recorded
yep.
on their record, not
okay.
always.
Okay.
And they don't always update that.
Yep.
And so that's, it gets to be a little
Do
bit
I get
more
that
of a
from
challenge.
An FR or?
You could work with them.
Okay.
I have some of my guy, I have a guy in the back. Are you kind of?
When people make their choice contributions, the church gets a letter of the names of the people who made the contributions.
Not
the
amount.
The amount.
Right.
Right. Right. I
right.
get that.
But you're
I
just looking.
We just do blanket, things in the church bulletins. So all my congregations get reminders. Please make your choice dollar contributions before March 31st, or you'll lose the 2015 choice dollars that you built up. And we really push it this time of year. And people don't like to do it quarterly, so I said we'll do it one time during the year, January to March 31st. And it cleans up the whole year. And they always think we had an old program where once you started it and did it, it always went there. You didn't have to call in, but now you have to call in. So but we just blanket up with little inserts. I've had some Lutheran schools that sent out just postcards reminding them we could really use your choice dollars and send it out to their whole alumni.
I think the other thing, another little thing on that is I think promoting the program more broadly brings awareness about what Thrive and Choice is. I think the other thing to the whole congregation versus just those that are eligible, that maybe that'll spur questions. I think the other thing that to think about is as you, as a church, as you receive those dollars, what are you doing with those? And if you can lift up what impact that has made within the congregation. My husband did a vicarage at a church where the Thrivent members actually came together and they identified three areas of focus that they were going to use Thrivent Choice dollars for and set those apart. One was for a health-related ministry, one was for special projects in the church, and the other was special projects outside the church. And this was a church that really kind of bemoaned the old AAL branch community, if you will. And so then those members would come together and make decisions on where to direct those dollars for special projects. So they created their own community. And it just raised awareness of Thrivent Choice in a different way. So I thought that was kind of
creative. We also put it in our church bulletin. We always show the last month's receipts. And they'll just show Thrivent Choice dollars coming in as a line item. And it's just a constant reminder that people do it, because if only 30 to 40% are doing it, there's a whole bunch of people that just let it go, and it's hundreds of thousands.
We're trying to get at why they're letting it go. It's a question in a lot of people's minds, so thanks for that.
Somebody back there, they had a hand up. Yes.
Yeah. It's a question about the, I take it as a book, if I understood that right. Was it the Genius of Generosity? Is that
yeah.
the one that, is it every member in the church is going through it for your month emphasis?
Yeah, so for a month, so we're using that in our small groups. So we've rewritten some of the small group guides, kind of customize that a little bit for what we're doing in our groups.
Okay.
And then we're preaching on Sunday mornings along that theme, but are doing that locally
okay.
there with us.
And
yeah.
Is that where more detail could be gotten about clear the shelves as well?
Oh,
or was that your own idea?
Yeah, if you want to, yeah, clear the shelves was something that came out of our team of people that were praying about that or thinking about that. So, yeah, if you want to grab one of my business cards or just want to reach out, we'd be happy to help or pass along whatever we can. Yeah.
I mean, I'm not looking for a program, but I'd like some more details on it.
Sure.
Boy,
yeah.
Sure. If this is a way to help or call.
Yeah. Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
First Emmanuel did something similar to that,
uh-huh.
not to the breadth that you did,
yeah.
but what was neat is we got a great number of people that turned out. I like the idea of using the bags because they can do it again and it reinforces
yeah.
the
yeah.
giving. But what happened is other community members then did the same.
Yeah.
They said, what are you all doing?
Mm-hmm.
So they went back in and got another shopping cart.
Yeah.
And then the owner, the longtime grocery owner of that store, turned around and gave more.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah. You know,
generosity breeds generosity.
Uh-huh. Absolutely. Yep. Community outreach is great.
Yeah, that's super. Great. Yes.
Yeah, my wife and I tried a different approach to generosity this past Christmas. We sent a check of $25 to each of our 8 grandchildren and left it blank, just signed it, and asked them to pick some sort of charity. You know? Oh. Not political, but charity.
Have any politicians in your family? Or?
But my reason for bringing it up is the first 2 grandchildren that responded go to school at First Emmanuel in Cedarburg.
Oh, is that right?
Yes.
Wow. Is that cool?
Yep.
Great. Any other questions? Thank you. You've been it's been really great to share with you and look forward to you us continuing this journey of generosity together. So enjoy the rest of the conference. Yeah. Thank you. Nate, thanks so much again.
You're welcome.
That's awesome. Inspired. Very good.
You know what? For some of you, what you're about to do about 700 people.
This is really good. Electronic.
Oh, cool. Right.
But I can run it 3 times.
I could look.
Good.
You are having a lot of fun with that, too.
Oh, you are? Yeah, it's awesome. It is awesome.
It sounds like it's going to be great.
Yeah, I think so too. I do think it's going to be one of those things where it'll be a catalytic kind of moment. It'll be one of those things where, you know, Vince and I talked about that. I'll probably be about, that'll fit into some more. You know, the remember when kind of conversation. It's going to really move a lot of people's personalities. Hey, thanks.
Absolutely.
There you go.
Good.
We've just started doing what we're talking about.
That's sort of good. That would be a good application for capability.
Oh, great.
It's all about documentation. You all sort of have to get out and getting awareness about how we can use the Lord as well.
That's on 25-40.
Yeah, right.
They love jumping on opportunities.
Yeah.
You do it every Sunday. I know. So do you that on Sunday morning where you send everybody out in the community? You do Saturday.
I was just talking about yesterday. This guy went golfing with his brother who lived in Cedar Avenue. So I was asking if he knew about the campaign.
Yeah.
And it's been, I have been over a new filmmaker.
But certainly.
So they
trying to educate people who are here about it.
They drive the kind of the 3DM, you know, strategy in terms of So they will do what they call out days every once in a while, but once a year or every other year at times where they will send their assigned church out on Sunday morning. So they'll line up all those different service agencies and just release the say, this is our active worship.
I'm pretty sure that building is parked not on his anymore.
Just remember, your solution is everything. Give him a t-shirt.
That's right. Run through a wall for you. We'll run through a wall for you. Well, we're
It's going somewhere.
Okay, Bill never came back.
I got his book in there.
Oh.
His hat's there.
Just 9 years.
See you later, brother.
All right, y'all have a good one.
Relaunch over west of here, mountains on the west side of town. Planning, working to go multi-site in the area, so it'll be good.
It's a very individual.
We learned how to be portable.
Started out and just gotten into the
industry. Cut our teeth longer than expected.
Very cool. Thanks
for...
Yeah, Sam Rice.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you for doing that.
Yeah.
You mentioned about the chocolate chip program with the surveyor and just getting started and all that. Is there plans for the kid? Just found out I have two funerals.
Yeah.
So I would have to pop out.
There are. You never know, but it's kind of grassroots. It's a little hard to predict. But if you, there's my email, and if you would just send me a note, I'll kind of keep you posted.
Well, blessings with your ministry.
Yeah, I'll keep you posted. Because
we're working towards
it. Yeah. It's nice to get to become part of the church.
That's what we want to do.
Yeah.
And there might be other things besides a two-year thing. Some of these congregations will do around generosity. So we'll I'll keep you in this game on this. Right. Good. Good. Well, blessings.
Anyway.
Anyway, nice to you.
Have you seen Brad's?
Yeah.
He made his difference between.